Now we're
We are
live.
now live. Oh, I didn't grab your comments yet. Let me do that.
I shared them, so you
I
just
know you
put
did.
that
I know you
on.
did. And now we should have a new one too, right?
I'll have to add it, yeah. Hi, everyone.
Hi,
We're
everyone.
live. We're just talking to each other.
Oh, are people watching this? Is that
Maybe,
what's
I don't
going
know.
On?
You can tell.
Saturn!
Yay.
Enjoy
Love it.
The Saturn.
The ears on that Saturn.
The ears attached to the side of that Saturn. Actually, that's the next video is talking about that.
Really?
Yeah,
I've got a
thing on why I love Saturn, and that's the next video that I've got coming out tomorrow.
Is it because he's like a punk rocker with big plugs in his ears, and now there's big loops because he took them out?
Well, Saturn just needs to go on a diet. It's got love handles.
Oh, there you go.
Okay, so you know what? I think there's people watching this, so let me get this started then. So hi, everyone. My name is Fraser Kane. I am the publisher of Universe Today, and this is your virtual star party for June 9th. 2013, and I think we got a really nice mix of scopes tonight, so I think this is going to be great. So joining us from Florida is David Saturn Dickinson, who is giving us this beautiful view of Saturn. Hey, David.
Hey, how you doing? Yeah, we actually cleared off from the thunderstorms we had a few hours ago, so I thought I would join in.
Well, and you had sort of warned us that you're going to have this horrible weather, and then everything
it's
just cleared
summertime.
Up nicely. Yeah.
Yeah, it's summertime. Sometimes it's clear in the morning here, about 4 or 5 o'clock, the convection dives down, but usually the evenings are pretty hit or miss. And even now, Saturn is very turbulent, I can tell. It's transiting right now over the meridian, so it's at its highest point. So
now,
these
jiggles that we're
get.
Seeing right now, this is not the atmosphere. This is you moving your telescope.
That's me keeping it centered because I only have it on a rough polar alignment, so it's drifting just a little bit left or right.
Yeah.
So every 5 minutes or so, I got to kind of jitter it back in the center.
This is reminding me about Cor Schmitz's hand guiding. So.
So which he won't be doing anymore because he's
no,
got
I know.
His
he's,
whole
he's built an
stuff.
Epic. Yeah, he's built a totally wonderful setup now.
I used to brag about him all the time, hand guiding a scope, and now like I'm gonna be cool and just have a go to.
So someone's saying that they can't comment on YouTube. I wonder why.
I don't know. I can try to comment on YouTube and see if that works.
Yeah.
This is a smart aleck comment. It's most likely from everybody.
Yeah. I'm not sure why people can't comment. Okay, well, anyways, that was David Dickinson, and I'm going to move on. We got Gary Ganella.
Hi, guys.
And Gary's in the Los Angeles area, and he's got M51 happening at some point.
I do, coming right up.
All right.
I commented on YouTube. It worked.
Did you? Yes. And we've got Peter Lake, a.k.a. the Astroswani from Australia, And you are remotely controlling your 20-inch plane wave telescope in the New Mexico area.
That's right.
With
yep.
your mind.
With my mind.
You're an astronaut. So we'll get some...
Welcome, everyone.
Yeah, we'll get a view of that in a second. And we got Ray Sanders, who is in... You're in Arizona, aren't you?
I am, just outside of Phoenix.
Awesome, a.k.a. the Dear Astronomer, and you've been doing a lot of educating for CosmoQuest. You're running some courses and stuff?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, right now I'm in the middle of a class doing the Sun and Stellar Evolution. So it's
You're
been a
in
pretty
class
good class.
Right now?
Right now, yeah.
Right now.
Right now.
Is there
going to
be a test?
there Those usually
courses.
Are.
Yeah.
There usually are tests.
And we got Scott Lewis. And
hey,
you are just back from an awesome trip on the Big Island.
Yes.
And so if we have a little extra time, maybe you can show us some pictures of you...
being awesome?
Well...
No.
Trying to get yourself killed.
Yes.
Is what you were doing.
Trying to catch myself on fire, because being a firefighter for 7 years wasn't enough.
It wasn't enough, yeah.
I wanted to find another way.
Yeah, exactly. I had to get close. And we got Stuart Foreman, who is clouded out, but he thought he would just bring his raw intelligence and also organizational skills, and so he's going to be queuing up objects for the other guys to get at. So, now this is a... I'm going to go back to the Saturn. You don't need to look at me. Let's look at Saturn. So this is an interactive experience where we showcase the night sky for you. You know, we've got a live view of Saturn right now, and I think that's all that's up in the sky for David's telescope.
For planets,
Yeah, for the planets and the moons and such. But we've got two telescopes going on deep sky objects. So if you want to make any comments, any questions, you want to ask about our setups, if you want to talk about, you know, give us some suggestions of objects that we can see, just let us know. Now you can post in comments, and there's a bunch of places that you can do that. One is you can post comments just on Google Plus if you're watching this on the event page there, or if you're just watching this in my stream on Google Plus, you can post a comment there. If you're watching this just embedded somewhere, you can just use like on Facebook, which apparently we've got a live version on Facebook right now, so you can post a comment there.
And oh, you don't can just comment use the, there,
please. Well, no, don't comment on Facebook. Yeah, we will not see Facebook. But you can, if you're using Twitter, we can use the hashtag StarParty.
Yes.
And if you are on YouTube, which is sort of the safest place to comment on, or usually is, although some people are telling us that we can't. So anyway,
I'm seeing a whole bunch of people confirming.
I am. There. Yeah. So you can. It's just. It was who wasn't able to? Was it Guido? Yeah. Anyway, so YouTube is kind of the safest place, so if it looks like we're ignoring your comments, YouTube is the place to post. And like I said, questions about gear, if you want us to explain the science a little more, if you want us to, go and pull up an object, if it's in the night sky, we'll do what we can. So, oh, Peter, this is just sick. Okay, I gotta show Peter's, well, let's start with Gary's view.
let's start off with Gary and then have it blown out of the water by Peter.
So I think it's really important to kind of understand the sort of the setups here, because I think this is going to show people sort of what a difference this is. So Gary's got, I always forget, 14-inch in Los Angeles, which is not a good place for night sky viewing. And he's got a sort of very specific wavelength that he can pull in with his setup, and so he's able to sort of cut through that atmospheric and light pollution and get these views of the sky. So this is
like light pollution. Besides the moon, I don't see any light pollution
in
H alpha.
Did you know that there are stars in Los Angeles? I'm sure.
Yeah, there's a big street that has them all over the place.
Yeah,
and it's really obnoxious when you walk around there.
Yeah. So this is M51.
That it is.
And Ray, do you have any opinion about M51?
Give us your opinion.
Give us your opinion. Give us your science knowledge.
Well, not your opinion. One of the reasons why I think the Whirlpool Galaxy is fascinating, both from a backyard astronomy standpoint and in the science standpoint, is that you're able to see the interaction between it and the satellite galaxy. So those tidal forces distorting the arms and the gravitational interaction between them, it makes for beautiful pictures, and it makes for a great thing to study scientifically.
And now I'm going over to Peter's view, and you can really see the difference here. So Peter's got a 20-inch telescope, so it's bigger, and it's also a sort of it's a kind of a different kind of telescope, right? It's a Ritchie Crichton.
Yeah, it's a CDK. So corrected Dalkirkham, which is not unlike a RCT, yeah.
Yeah.
So, it's great, and it's a high end scope that it's kind of my self funding hobby. So I share it out with other scientists in universities and around the world, and because I can only use it 10 to 20 hours a month myself. So.
Yeah.
But for that reason, it's pretty good, and it's remotely hosted, and it's deep sky, so the field of view I think is about 37 arc minutes across. So I'll get the exact 37 by 24. Roughly, from memory.
Gary's view here, we'll swap over to Gary's view. So Gary's got set up with a really wide field of view. So he's set up that he can get, what is it, 3 moons across and 2 moons up. So he can get sort of six full moons in that field of view that you're looking at right now.
I'm 60 arc minutes by 90 arc minutes, if you want to know the numbers.
Right. And Peter, you were saying yours is about 30?
Yeah, 37 by 24.
Right, so you could probably fit 4 of Peter's views into Gary's view.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so Gary's view is really great for these really big, big objects, big nebula, like the Rosette Nebula, for example, which I think people have seen in the commercial, in the Google video commercial.
We'll get those in the next few weeks.
So, we'll Gary, can you fit all of Andromeda in your view?
Yes. Yeah, as much as I can pull out.
Yeah, because the way that Fraser was describing it, and that's about the rough, you know, angular diameter of Andromeda in the night sky is about 6 full moons. So when he was describing that, I was curious if you could fit in all of Andromeda in your images.
Yeah, let me. I'll pull it up here in a second. I was going to do one thing here real quick, real fur.
So there's a question here from Jeff Goodall. What is that little slit just below and off to the side of M51?
I suspect it might be another galaxy, I think, Fraser. Is it down in the bottom left-hand corner there?
Yeah.
I don't know if they're talking about that dark band in the top.
Yeah, so I'm not
the
sure.
Top right where that dark band is, that could just be a dust lane that we're not able to see through.
Yeah, so just to give people an idea of sort of where things are, Ray, can you, so we've got a couple of people want to see Venus, they want to see Andromeda, and they can't, and they also want to see Jupiter, and they can't. I'm so sorry. I guess you could.
No, you're not.
West Coast might get Venus right now.
Yeah.
West Coast might.
I saw Venus last week, but that was also pretty south.
Yeah.
Venus sets fast, though. I was using it to do the focus on my telescope earlier this week, and I was doing some ISS photography. And, I mean, I literally, made some adjustments on my camera.
Yeah.
It's gone.
So I'm just going to go back to the Saturn view here and sort of just talk a bit about the positions of the planets right now. So right now, if you go out and you look to the west just after sunset, and David, you're going to, tell me if I'm wrong here, but you can just see Jupiter and Mercury and Venus right now, right?
Yeah, those are all over in the west right now. Jupiter is just about gone for the season. It's going in behind the sun right now. But you're getting Mercury this week is one of the best weeks to see it for this year for Northern Hemisphere.
And when will Jupiter pop out from the other side of the sun?
Probably in July, in mid-July, we'll start picking it up in the morning. I've been trying to pick up Mars. I haven't been successful yet, but Mars will start sliding into the morning sky.
Well, and Mars is pretty massive, so if you can lift Mars, man,
Now, when's opposition on Mars?
Mars for the next opposition is in 2014, sometime in the spring.
So it's going to go really bright next year.
Mars reaches opposition about every 26 months.
Do you remember when Mars was at that closest point in 50,000 years?
Yes, 2003. Yeah,
it was so bright. I mean, there was no question.
It was the size of the moon, wasn't it?
It was the size of the moon.
You beat me to it, Scott.
Yeah, it was so bright. So just to kind of get back to that request that people are making. So, yes, we could, if we had a person on the West Coast, for example, if Stuart was set up and he went down to the coast and set himself up with a nice view to the western horizon, as opposed to the trees and the houses and stuff all around his viewing area, he might be able to get Jupiter and Venus and Mercury just for a few minutes until they went down.
Jupiter would be very difficult, right?
And they would look terrible because they're very low on the horizon.
Well, and I just checked in Stellarium from my position here in around Phoenix, and Jupiter's well past set, along with Venus. Being a little further westward might help
a little bit. Can you share that with the class, Ray?
I certainly can.
If you watch on the SOHO ESA SOHO satellite, they show the LASCO C3 transits where the camera is looking at the sun. Jupiter is going to be entering the field of view this week, where you'll start seeing Jupiter from SOHO looking at the sun.
Oh, that's really cool. So just to kind of give people just a general gist of this, in the spring we're seeing Saturn. So we're going to get Saturn from, we've had it for maybe a month now, and we'll get it through until, end of the summer?
I think November is when it's in solar conjunction, November or December.
Okay.
There's going to come a point in the virtual star party later this year we won't have planets during the time that we're doing it.
No!
They're disappearing.
So Fraser, I've got
Stellarium up from last week from Mauna Kea, though, if that counts. So this tiny little dot here. But this is me in Hawaii at 13,000 feet.
Gasping for breath.
Gasping for breath, but yeah. You can barely make out Venus last week as the sun's setting.
Yeah. So Stephen Birch says, so Australia would have a good shot of Jupiter at this point. No, they see the same thing. They have the same problem.
Yeah, it's behind the sun there as well. So
yeah,
going behind the sun. So they get a better view of Saturn because Saturn's in the southern. It's in the southern celestial hemisphere right now. So Saturn for them would be up high overhead. The further south you go.
Yeah.
So real quick, here in Stellarium, I've turned on the landscape so we can see the horizon, and Mercury, at least from here, just outside of Phoenix, Mercury is just a hair above the horizon. And if I were to turn off the ground, then we can see the Sun well past set, Jupiter well past set, Venus just kind of cleared the horizon probably about half an hour ago.
Yeah.
So... but that helps give everybody an idea of where things are at.
But Venus is going to be getting higher in the sky, and so I think, you know, within a couple of weeks, I'm sure we'll have a chance to view it.
It's slowly coming in from behind the sun right now. It's just at a gibbous phase. It's not showing any detail or any kind of real phase to it.
Still, it's great to see that phase shape of Venus. Yeah. So
tomorrow
and
evening...
I was just getting ready to mention... one of the things that's very interesting about Venus is that it behaves the exact opposite that you would think it would when it's the brightest in the night sky. It's actually a very thin crescent, and when it's its dimmest, it's almost fully illuminated.
Yeah.
So just last week, Venus was at 95% illumination, and throughout the rest of the year, it's going to just get brighter and brighter and brighter throughout the year, and people with telescopes who look at Venus... instead of it being a kind of roundish orb type thing, it's going to start moving into more of a crescent shape.
So we've got a bunch of requests here. I don't know where Gary, where you and Peter are at.
Number one, they asked about the filters. There was a question,
yep.
And I put this up. This is basically visible light, and it's measured in nanometers, and it goes from just below 500 to above 700, so it's 200 and some nanometer total beam width. The hydrogen alpha I'm using is right here, and it's 12 nanometers.
Right.
So out of that over 200, I'm taking a very, very thin slice right here, and that's what's given off by excited hydrogen.
Got it.
Like, woo, I'm hydrogen.
Yeah.
And, now, in professional astronomy, we use filters, you know, things like on the Hubble and whatnot. And typically, the standard imaging filter set, we refer to them as BV, R, and I. So blue, and then visible, and then red, and then an infrared filter. We can also expand those out with the infrared filters to J, H, and K. And we can use those filters to look at different objects and see how strong of a signal we're getting in each filter. And then, of course, take all those images and throw them together and get pretty, pretty color pictures.
So I just want to go back to this view of Saturn here. So, I mean, this is pretty much what you would see. I mean, the great thing about this view of Saturn is this is live.
Right.
So you can see it jiggling around. You can see the atmospheric distortion. But, I mean, you can see the gap in the rings. You can see the Cassini division in this image, and you can see some bands across the planet.
Yeah, you can also see that back on about the 10 o'clock position or so on the disk that the shadow is starting to cast, the planet's shadow is starting to cast on the rings just a little bit. I see a little bit of a notch right there.
Right, yeah, I'm seeing that too.
Because we passed opposition, and now that as we go toward quadrature, that shadow is, we're starting to see it at a little bit of an angle right now.
Yeah.
I mean, it's great. Yeah. This is what you see when you look through a telescope. I remember that first time I looked at Saturn. And this is what you're seeing. It's going to look a little smaller to you, obviously, if you have this embiggened on your screen. But you're going to see this beautiful, like, slightly dimmed out yellowish blob, and you can start making out the rings in the Cassini division, and sometimes you can see the shadow on there, too. And it does take...
Oh, that's great. Yeah, keep that up, David.
Yeah, more. I like that, David.
Can you go any bigger?
That's
can you fly us out there?
Can you fly us out there?
That's
but no, it's great to have that bigger view, but you can just see that. Yeah, you can see that Yeah, that shadow forming over there. Now, someone asked if we could see the moons. And so, yeah, we can see the moons. And last week, I think, or 2 weeks ago, Mike Phillips was starting to sort of show us a bunch of moons. And we definitely saw Titan and a couple of others. The issue is that you need to change the brightness. So the brightness of the planet is very different compared to the brightness of the moons. And so you have to sort of modify the brightness of the image to be able to show one or the other. Can you change the brightness of yours?
I can give it a try.
You want to give that a try and see if we can see a moon or two?
The problem with Titan as opposed to like the Jovian moons is it's actually a magnitude too faint.
Yeah.
Let me see if I can really boost it up here a little
bit. Got a request for Comet Ison. Now, I know, Peter, you've got Comet Pan-STARRS, right? So let's go. We're going to go see that in a second here.
So we've got Comet Pan-STARRS there. I think from Comet Lemons in the morning sky at the moment, so it's not up yet. Comet Pan-STARRS, I think, is pretty much all up all night. I could have a go at that, but it's still not as bright as Comet Pan-STARRS. Sorry,
and
Comet Ison.
When are we expecting that we'll be able to see Comet Ison? Because you know, a lot of people want to see this, the greatest comet ever, right?
Yeah, I think last time I looked, it was about magnitude 14 or 15, I think, from memory.
So the very limits of a
telescope.
Yeah,
so it's up most of the night, I think. So I will see if I can grab it quickly.
David, when are we expecting Ison to really brighten up?
Ison should, well, it's hard to tell how it's going to perform. Hopefully this fall, before it goes in to pass around the sun, we should start getting it above magnitude 10, which is, then it will be a binocular telescope comet, backyard comet. Naked eye, it might break it by October. But the really big question mark is if it's going to survive its perihelion passage right after Thanksgiving in late November. There is a good possibility that Ison may go in and not come back out, which, you know, would be kind of a bummer.
Yeah.
Because I think the brightest it's going to be is going to be after it passes behind the sun, after it passes perihelion. But that's the big question mark.
Yeah, and so really, I mean, we're not going to know whether Ison is going to be, a flame out or the greatest comet in living memory until the end of this year.
That's the two choices we have to pick from, basically.
Yeah, yeah, or somewhere in between, you know.
Yeah.
But if it's not the greatest comet in living memory, then it will be a disappointment.
Yeah. So let me break in with a little bit of science here. Part of the reason why there's a big guessing game as to how bright some of these comets are going to be and if they're going to survive their encounter with the sun is that some of these, we haven't tracked their orbits for enough times to know whether or not this is their first pass around the sun. So some of the older comets, like, you know, Halley's Comet, and the other older ones that we've tracked for several passes or have known their orbit backwards through, you know, several encounters, they've made passes around the sun, they've survived, and they'll, you know, continue for some time. But if a comet is making its first pass around the sun, it's a big question mark because these comets are just kind of a loosely grouped together ball of ice and dust, and sometimes they come around the sun and there's not much, if anything, left of them, and sometimes they come around and it's spectacular. We'll have to wait and see.
Gary, just you're showing us M101, but just before that, I know you had put up Andromeda. Can we go back to that for a second?
Yeah, I'll put that up. I want to bring M101 because we had new objects.
Someone asked for Andromeda, and so again, Andromeda is one of these objects that we can't see right now. We were showing Andromeda every night, all in the fall and into the winter, but now it's already set. This is the image that Gary gets of Andromeda.
Yeah, that's my field of view with Andromeda.
Yeah.
And so how long did it actually take to make that, though? That's not a snapshot.
No. This is, number one, under dark skies, taken with red, green, and blue filters. So it's real color. And there's about 45 minutes to an hour exposure at each color.
Okay.
Multiple 10-minute shots.
Yeah. But even so, I mean, even the ones that you do in in 2 minutes for us still look great. You can see the spiral arms. You can really see those dust lanes and even the star clusters in Andromeda. It's just great. So.
Yep.
All right. Why don't you go back to the live image now?
Okay. Here we go. I'm going to save it.
What else? Yeah, someone said
Gary's image of Andromeda is just great. It's in my field of view, it only gets about half of it. It's yeah. such a massive object.
It's so big, well, yeah. And Andromeda is one of these objects that you go out and you can see it with your own eyeballs if you kind of know where to look right. on a nice, you know, if you've got dark skies, you know, there's a great big fuzzy patch in the sky, and that's Andromeda.
Well, having binoculars works great too for that.
Yeah, it's actually really cool to look at Andromeda, and then another object that's night sky or human eye visible in the night sky is the Great Globular Cluster in Hercules. SC Object 13. That one, even in somewhat suburban, like bordering on suburban and rural skies, you can actually pick it out if you've got decent vision. So,
yeah.
But Andromeda does. It's very diffuse, so it does get washed out pretty easily once you start, you know, getting towards the suburbs. But if you're out in pitch black skies, out in the middle of nowhere, it's very easy to spot.
Somebody said the next star discovered should be named after a me or any of the co-creators. But you actually can't name stars after people. Is the problem. So, you know, any of those, like, name a star services, they're actually not approved by the International Astronomical Union. They all have to remain numbers. Now, asteroids, the discoverer can name them after people. And I do have one named after me. So that's kind of, we're already there. And I think it was Jeff, the blue collar astronomer, and he actually passed away a couple of years ago, and he was a very prolific asteroid hunter and named a whole bunch of asteroids after a bunch of people in the sort of astronomy space skeptic community, and they do a star party for him every year at to sort of raise funds for leukemia research at Dragon Con, and usually that's like the first night before Dragon Con they do a fundraiser for Jeff Metcalf, and so it was, I was really honored that he actually named an asteroid after me, and who else, Phil Plait, I think, and George Robb got one, and so
that's great too with him, and that we were able to bring the virtual star party to Dragon Con this year, to help help with the fundraising as well. So it's great to be able to raise more awareness on that fundraising.
Oh, and so Stuart is going to show off his version of Andromeda.
Yeah, so this was about a little over an hour of data. And this was taken with a DSLR in my front yard, which is a light-polluted sky, not as light-polluted as Gary's. But it is pretty light blue. I have a street light right across the street from my house, and so this was my attempt. And this is what you can get just with a DSLR.
Yeah.
And it's pretty good.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
If we're sharing, terrific. I'll share mine. Well, not mine, but this is from the Mount Wilson Observatory, so taken with the 100-inch Hooker telescope. And so, yeah, this is the Great Spiral System Andromeda, back when we thought it was a nebula, because we didn't have galaxies back then outside of the Milky Way. So this is one of the images taken with glass plates.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Mount Wilson.
I'm going to go back to Gary's view now. So Gary's got this view of M101.
Right. And this is a two-minute exposure binned 2x2. So I can't have a little bit of room to zoom in on it.
Now, I've got a question from Dave3200. What method do people use to clean the glass on the telescope? David, what's your suggestion for cleaning a telescope?
I don't, unless I absolutely have to.
Don't get it dirty.
Stuart, you've got a refractor, right?
Right. What I'll do is, every once in a while, I'll take a camel hair brush and very carefully brush off the objective, and that's really about it. You really want to be careful with it, because the optics are coated optics, and you don't want to scratch, and so you can get by with a little bit of dust, it'd be okay, but I don't do anything more than just using a camel hair brush and just, you know, brushing it off.
Scott was cleaning mine.
Oh, Gary, so how do you clean yours?
I don't.
You don't.
That front corrector plate is 14-inch, and you can see the dirt on it, but from everything I see, is it generally isn't worth cleaning it until you can't see through it. And then it would be a 7 hour.
That's right.
So yeah. Go ahead.
So one of the interesting things is We've got a number of telescopes at New Mexico Skies, where mine is. We use a carbon dioxide gun to just blow the dust off the mirror periodically, and the primary and the secondary. Because one of the purposes of taking flats is to help you identify any defects in your image train, and then to subtract those out. So often in an uncalibrated image, you'll see little donuts of an out-of-focus dust particle or something like that. But typically, when you take your mirror out and wash it, periodically you might get them recoated if the covering is peeling off the mirror after a couple of years. Put them in an acid bath, and then you get them recoated on the back, and then you put them back in, and away you go. And your optic train is as good as new. But typically telescopes, they do gather a bit of dust, and you just blow it off with a carbon dioxide gun, and then.
So what if somebody's got has picked up an older telescope, and maybe it's been sitting in someone's attic for a while, and it's clearly had kid fingers smudging the lenses? What
you don't
do?
Buy it.
Astronomers just throw out their telescopes when they get too greasy?
No, I mean you can get optical cleaners, and if you're really really careful, you can. Probably get by with making it better, but it's one of those things that whenever you mention cleaning to an astronomer, we always sort of wince, for that reason.
Yeah.
But you got to do what you got to do.
Right. I mean, what they do up at Mount Wilson, or what they used to do up at Mount Wilson, is that you would have to completely re-silver the mirror. You don't clean it.
Yeah.
You completely resurface it.
They do that generally every 18 months to 2 years.
On the 60-inch, some of the guys, when I was there last year, they would climb up into it with a big garden hose compressed to a tank of carbon dioxide. And it would actually pour water, so it looked like they were just spraying it off with a garden hose with water, but it's actually CO2. I don't know if it's different for the 100. It probably sounds like it is from what you're saying.
Back when they were doing science for it, it's not really used anymore for science besides doing some regular research. But you have to completely re-silver the primary mirror, which makes sense. You don't want to mess up any scratches when you're trying to do any of the scientific research going on up there.
Yeah. So does anyone want to explain M101, which is what we're looking at right now, from Gary Ray?
I got it here in a second.
It's the Pinwheel Galaxy.
Yeah.
And it's pretty. And you can see why it's named the Pinwheel. I mean, it's like you're going to the fair and you're waiting for it to start spinning right in front of you.
Well, am I still muted?
No,
you're good.
Oh, okay, I thought I was still muted. So, Pinwheel Galaxy being another, textbook spiral galaxy, and actually another one that's a great learning tool because you can readily see its spiral arms, unlike some of the other galaxies that you can image in the night sky, like the Sombrero Galaxy. That one, you see it edge on, so you can't really see much of its spiral structure. And, this is about, I think about 20 million light years away. Just a spiral galaxy.
It's had looks like 3 supernova in the 20th century.
Yeah.
And the nice thing about these edge-on spirals the face-on spirals is that when they have a supernova, you can take a before and after picture, and then all of a sudden you see a really, really bright star that wasn't there before. And that's how people, amateurs, discover them.
In the comments, Jason H. is mentioning, don't use canned air, because some of them will spray your optics with propellants that will permanently damage the coatings on your optics. So don't do that.
He's right.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Another comment here, Sterling Gothrop asks, could it be possible to catch the ISS in the virtual star party? So I have a wish list. I have a bucket list, which I have sort of unleashed on the various astronomers, daring any one of them to attempt to bring this into the star party. So one is we want to get a spacecraft live, get the International Space Station live. Mm-hmm. And, Ray, have you got an image of it?
I do have an image of it. It's not live, but I'll be more than happy to share it. I'm sorry?
I've imaged it through my rig, but we would have to be tracking it. That would be the
problem. Yeah, so right. What's amazing about the International Space Station is that with a pair of binoculars, you can see it.
Yeah.
You know, you can see this. It looks like an H in the sky. So if you know when it's passing over, you get your binoculars out. You can, you know, and but then with a telescope, it looks even better. But it's moving so fast that it's really hard to be able to keep track of it. And so you need to have a really special rig. And there's a few people in the world who have actually like custom built telescope mounts, and they've got special software designed just for tracking these spacecraft, and that's where you get these amazing views of like the space station passing in front of the sun and things like that. So that's on my bucket list. That's on my wish list. I would love to get the International Space Station. I want to get a meteor shower. So I've been talking to Corey about this. So we're going to try and do, you know, in an upcoming one, we're going to try and capture meteors. So maybe for the Perseids, and we'll just set up a wide view of the sky and just keep waiting and watching. And if we see a meteor, we'll just switch to that view and try and show it. I'd love to do aurora, so yeah. Find somebody in Alaska or Sweden or something who can try and just put a long exposure view of the sky.
I'll have to see, because we have Jukka Laakso up in Finland. I'll have to see if he's north.
Yeah, that would be amazing. Nice. I'd love to see some star trails, so people can really get a sense of how the sky sort of turns as we watch. So anyway, so these are on my bucket list, and getting a spacecraft live, even if like watching the ISS pass over like a star trail would be fantastic. But.
Well, and you could do that, and the star trails from a meteor shower, you could do both of those with an all sky camera. So maybe that's one of the things that we can poke around our little community of astronomers and see if someone's got an all-sky camera. Real quick, I was going to mention, on my ISS image, this is the first time that I ever attempted to image the ISS. I did it on Thursday night's pass. I had my 80-millimeter refractor telescope connected to my DSLR. I was basically using it like a big zoom lens. And I was tracking this whole thing by hand. I was not using a tripod. I was not using a $50,000 rig. It was just my two hands and an 80-millimeter telescope. I actually, Fraser, you were mentioning that, you know, some of the prominent people who do ISS flyovers, one of them's Thierry Legault.
Yes,
Thierry Legault. I actually emailed him. Emailed him these pictures and asked him about some technical tips, and he actually replied back and said that, you know, because I sent him the specs of my telescope and everything, so he was actually rather impressed with such a small telescope and doing everything by hand that I was able to get, A, anything at all, and B, something that somewhat, not quite, but maybe resembles the space station, so.
Well, that's terrific, so let's see it live next, Ray.
Well, there's this website, Universe
Data,
Today.
Amazing.
Yeah. This website, Universe Today, that whoever publishes that.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't
that
trust
rag?
Yeah.
Some guy in the basement.
Yeah.
I don't know if you can see it on my screen, but this is a friend of mine by the name of Ted Judah who did this from his observatory in Sonoma County. And Fraser grabbed it. Nancy looks like she grabbed it and took a. This is a Space Shuttle Discovery on the International Space Station, taken from his backyard.
And I'm always recommending people go to NASA's spotthestation.nasa.gov, key in your email address, your location, and you'll get an email a few hours before the space station is going to fly overhead.
Right. And there's apps on your Android and iOS.
Tons of apps. Yeah. I mean, every time we look into it, it just gets, there's more and more things. The one that seems to be malfunctioning, sadly, is Twist, TWISST, which is on Twitter. A lot of people.
Yeah, he's been offline for a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. Probably at least 6 months, if not longer. That's why I switched to the Spot the Station from NASA. It's because I stopped getting tweets with the Spot the Station emails. The most amount of time that I've gotten for advance notice of a flyover has been about like 12 hours, and the least amount of time that I've gotten is about 4.
And so what? So I mean, when you get
that, enough to plan.
So when you get the email from Spot the Station, just put it into your into your calendar, so you get a notification for the exact like a minute before it happens. And then if you're if you're at a restaurant or if you're at a friend's place or you're out and about and you're like, oh hey, check this out, and you walk outside and you point up and there goes the International Space Station, and they'll just think you're some kind of wizard.
And trust me, the ISS is incredibly easy to see in the night sky, even in like a brightly lit city like LA. I don't know about maybe like trying to do it from Times Square in New York. work.
Yeah.
But when you're even in a bright city, because it outshines Venus in the night sky when it makes its flyover, so it's really easy to spot. It kind of does fly over like a plane, but you don't see the blinking lights like a plane does. It's just this bright white pin of light that moves through the sky, and it moves from one horizon to the other in about 5 or 6 minutes of time, so it's fast.
So I just want to remind you, if you're watching this on YouTube, or if you're not, that you'll want to subscribe to the channel. I'm not sure if you can find it, because then you'll get a notification when we're about to go live through YouTube as well. So it's, and if you do this later or just do this in another browser, just go to the to YouTube and search for Fraser Cain, or it the YouTube user's user universe today, and then subscribe to the channel there, and that will make sure that you'll be sort of get notifications of when we do some live streaming and stuff, so it'll pop into your feed. This is one of the hardest problems that we've had, is people are like, I never find out when you guys do these things.
Right.
And we're trying to sort of utilize every technology that we can.
So, yeah, we have Twitter now, so it's the underscore VSP, or it's the Virtual Star Party on Facebook.
On Facebook, so
follow us all over the place. We're trying to get everything organized to last them all out.
And the other thing is we wrap a lot of this around in the event page on Google Plus. And so if you go to the event for the latest event and click on yes, you'll attend, then each week we duplicate the event and it tries to invite everybody who was on the last event.
Right.
I'm really blue right now. I don't have my brighter light set up.
Do you need a hug?
I'm so sad. Yeah. it's okay. So, Gary, what have we got here?
This is the Iris Nebula that I think... somebody suggested, NGC 7023. And I've got some longer exposures of this, but you can see its structure here. It almost looks like a squished bug. Legs that come up like that and down.
Oh, here. Yeah.
William Wigg is recommending satellite AR on Android, which sounds great. Okay, moving on. That's great. Now, you said you have some longer, like some photographs that you've taken of this.
Yeah. If you want to see those, I can pop them up.
Yeah, while we're waiting for another image from Peter.
Sorry, I've maxed out my memory, and I'm trying to close a few things down here because I've got so much stuff open. It's
I'm going to go back to that view of Saturn.
Yeah,
I think this is one of the longest, most dependable images of Saturn, views of Saturn we've had all season, David.
Yeah, it's pretty good right now. Yeah, it's actually it managed to cool down and clear off just a little bit. So it's actually going down right now. Probably in a few hours it'll be set from here.
Oh, I'm going to go back to Gary's view here.
What's that?
Is it monochrome for you? Or is it color?
That's just a tinge of color. If I crank the color on it too much, you get fringes on it. So it's nearly monochrome.
So I think
emission nebula, right?
Yeah, look at that. So this is the sort of longer exposure view that Gary had done.
Oh, wow, Gary.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
Yeah, I'm real happy the way that came out.
Looks like an evil monster staring at you.
What was your technique with this, Gary?
I've got to have to look back and look at my notes.
Okay.
This is a couple years old, so I've got to... I don't remember what I did here or where.
And your name...
Huh?
No, this is a reflection nebula, is what this is.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, I was just getting ready to say the Iris Nebula is a reflection nebula, just mentioned that, Stuart.
Yeah.
So what that is you still have a bright star in the center, like you do with some emission nebula, but instead of the star ionizing all the gas, like a street lamp or a neon sign, where that gas is really excited and it starts throwing off light, you're just getting the light from that bright star bouncing around and, like the name says, being reflected instead of making the gas glow.
It's 6 light years across. That's 1,300 great. Light years away.
That's right. Oh, so Scott, can we see that photo that you took of you on Mauna Kea endangering yourself?
Is that the one where you're wearing a dress?
On Kilauea?
No, and that's not a dress, and I will punch you. No, that wasn't on Mauna Kea.
That was Kilauea, later. Right.
Kilauea, right.
Yeah, yeah.
Which one when I was endangering myself? I was going on a 12-kilometer hike on a lava flow.
Well, I want to see the part where you're digging that rock out with a stick.
Yeah, let me
see. The lava.
That lava. We got so many of them. Here we go.
Yeah, and then people can see the. I want you to show the comparison of your brand new rock and your old rock.
Yes. So this is me playing with lava, and this is my other co-host mom, Siromi Samarasinghe, and we're in Hawaii playing with lava, which is freaking awesome. I mean, it's hot, so hot, and this is after already walking 7 kilometers. And you're like, hey, I'm not dehydrated enough. Let's go play with some molten rock. And it was absolutely phenomenal. Let me see if I can get some better images coming up here, too.
That is kind of dangerous, isn't it?
If you fall in it, you're not gonna have a good time.
Yeah.
But
you brought a souvenir back. Let's see the souvenir.
I did. So this, to compare, this is my 4.5-billion-year-old rock. Or nickel iron, so not.
Haven't you got one too, Stuart? Oh, you can't.
Yes,
hear
I do have one. Yes, thanks. But it's downstairs.
This is okay. My 5-day
I can go get it.
No,
it looks
mine.
Sort of like,
it looks. And that's five-day-old rock.
5 days old, right?
That's amazing.
So I literally pulled this out of the earth, and
you're like a midwife,
mine. Right? I feel like a midwife. And then, yeah, here you go. Here's another one where it's really hot there. And you see that the logs we're using is catching on fire. I mean, it just goes up in flames as soon as you play with the lava.
So, Scott, did you make any Dr. Evil jokes about boiling hot magma?
No. Nope. No. We were so exhausted already out there. And because you have to carry all your water, right?
Yeah.
And there's... So I was carrying 3 liters... 3.5 liters with me, and yeah, you're just exhausted. But it was phenomenal getting brand new planetary stuff. You know, it's crystallized rock. And when you're talking about planetary formation, the age of things, you know, the meteorites that we've shared so far with Stuart, Fraser, and myself, this is stuff that formed with our solar system. When the Earth formed, this is the same things that are happening. When it crystallized, and this is new crystallized rock.
Yeah,
that's 5 days old, and I have one that's 30 years old, which is kind of cool. I picked it up because it's my Earth donut. Because you can.
This is a 30-year-old donut.
It's a 30-year-old Earth donut. You see right through it.
That's cool.
Hello.
Nice.
And you had one too, Ray.
Yeah, I was actually showing off. This one's Campo de Cielo. It's an iron nickel meteorite from Argentina. Yep. And this one, I keep it in the display case. But it's about 32 grams. So not really that big, but big enough. And I'm actually, as far as meteorite collecting, I actually go for all the iron and nickels. I've got a few other ones where they've been sliced open to show the pattern of their crystallization. Those ones make great display cases or display pieces. But meteorite hunting can be expensive.
Well, this one comes from Phil Plate. So when I met Phil Plate for the first time, he gave me a nickel iron meteorite.
And this is Mauna Kea, by the way.
Oh, great.
So a little bit different terrain. It's a little cooler up there, too. It's around 7 Celsius.
And could you feel the altitude up there?
Well, we stopped at the visitor center, which is around 9,000 feet, and this is 13,500 feet we're at right there. So you have to stop and acclimate. One of the people in our party, he went ahead of us for a little bit, and he had to be turned around and go to the hospital because of altitude sickness. So you feel it's a little bit harder to breathe, but if you acclimate yourself at the 9,000 foot mark and then go up about a half hour later, you're fine. And it was amazing. You can see Maui rising up out of the clouds as the sun's setting. It was just
Okay, so I'm going to go to get back to some telescoping here, and we've got Gary's view of M81 and M82. This is a great image of M81 and M82. Look at the spiral arms there.
That's what it is.
Yeah. And so what's great about these two galaxies is they're actually interacting gravitationally. And so M82, which is that smaller one, is yanking with its gravity, pulling out the arm from M81. It's terrific. How long was this exposure, Gary?
This is 2 minutes, bend 4x4.
So when you're saying bend, because I know that's a piece, you know, it's a piece of jargon that most people don't understand. What do you mean by binning for your image?
The way the CCD is laid out, mine is about 2,000 by 3,000 pixels. Right. And I can take each separate pixel where the light hits and make a pixel out of them. If I bin like a 2x2, I take every 2 vertical and every 2 horizontal and make a cube that is 4 pixels and add them together. So okay. I get the light of 4 areas. When I do a 4x4 bin, I'm actually taking blocks of 16 pixels, adding them up. So for short stuff like this, it works great. If right. I can have longer exposures, I can get the full resolution. But if I did this at full resolution, there wouldn't be much there in a 2-minute exposure.
Yeah. And so just to compare, so here's Stuart's view, and this is, again, a sort of longer exposure.
Yeah, this is an hour, taken with the DSLR. So slightly less noise, obviously. And one thing that we're not seeing in this view, which Mike Chasen, who every once in a while comes into the VSP, he's shown beautifully, there's actually an interaction between these two galaxies called a flux. And you can't see it at all in this view, but in his, you can the space in between just has this stuff moving in between them, and it's really, really neat to look at.
That's great.
I really love that you got the red burst coming out of it.
Yeah, that looks fantastic. That's really great. And it's great. So you just so people understand, so you use a DSLR, and
correct.
So you use like a Canon.
Yeah.
Rebel, right?
Correct. T1i Rebel. Mine's modified, although the modification wouldn't really do much in this particular view. But
So your modification—that's the IR sensor being removed, the IR filter.
Right, and then it has a cut UV IR filter put in its place.
Right. Oh, cool. I think we're gonna wrap up in a second here, but. Just going to get one last view of Saturn. David, you've been like a rock. Well, like a very jiggly rock.
Yeah, I don't dare lose it. It took me about 30 minutes to acquire it because the field is so narrow with this.
Yeah.
I have to visually acquire it with the wide field. Then I have to put the Barlow and the high power lens in it. And then it's a matter of trying to get the focus and everything lined up right. But the field of view is very small for this.
But this is great. I mean, this has been our best view of Saturn, I think, for the season. Well, I think we had a higher resolution view, but this has just been a really dependable view just for the whole star party, which has been great.
Yeah. No clouds.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's just terrific. Wow.
So Fraser, I'm just having a little bit of trouble throwing the image up on the screen, but I will upload it. I've got M64 here as well, but I've run out of memory in my
memory on your computer,
and it doesn't want to go. So I'll upload it to
Can you hold up? Can you print it off and hold up a picture or something?
Right.
Yeah.
Can you pantomime what's going on in your image?
Yeah. Can you do an interpretive dance for what you're seeing right now?
Well, it's M64, which is, I think, the Black Eye Galaxy. And
all right. So punch yourself in the face. And
object, and it's a very beautiful galaxy. So I'll upload it in the event photos.
And like a lot of things named in astronomy, the objects are named because they resemble something. When you see the image that Peter's going to post, the Black Eye Galaxy is called that because it really does look like a black eye. It's got a very dark band ring in part of it. So it really kind of does look like somebody, you know, popped at one and gave it a shiner.
I think we should rename it the Winking Raccoon Galaxy.
Well, careful though. We have to be careful about Raccoon. We don't want to get Marvel with Guardians of the Galaxy, you know, lawsuit happy.
Oh.
I have one that I did. It's another, I think, 2-hour exposure.
Oh,
so
okay.
You can take a look.
So here
you
go.
You can see the black eye in it.
Yeah, totally. Can you try zooming in on this?
I can try.
Yeah, just over on the right there and just slide it. Yeah.
Enhance.
Yeah, enhance. Zoom and enhance. We're cooking. Yeah.
There, nice.
That fills the screen. Perfect. Do that in the future. Oh, whoa. Two enhanced.
We're heading straight for it.
Yes. That's terrific. Okay, well, I think Gary's put up one last image here, so we're gonna see. Oh, nice. Have you got an M104, Stuart?
No, I don't, actually.
right.
I was here. I was just muted myself. But this one shows the disadvantage of the field of view I have.
Yeah.
You know, a much smaller field of view would give you a lot more information here. And as we start to move in, you can start to see that, especially since this has been 4x4, you can see the stars start to turn into squares.
M104, that's the Sombrero, isn't it?
That is the Sombrero Galaxy, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that one I don't have. It's kind of low in the south, and the south for me is covered with trees and streetlights, so...
Yeah. All right, well, let's wrap things up then. So I'm going to start with David, and we can see David now. Hey, David.
Hey.
Well, that was great, and I love the red flashlight there. That's awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and so can you sort of show people, illuminate your telescope? I don't know if we can really see it very well.
Let's see here if I can turn that. I've got a big floodlight out here, so you can see the back of it. Yep. I actually got my blue snowball mic finally working now.
So oh, it nice. Sounds great. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Nothing that reinstalling the system wouldn't fix.
So, David, is that the CPC 800?
The camera?
No, the telescope. It's an 8-inch SCT. I didn't know if that was the CPC 800. So,
this one's about 15 years old. I got this back in the mid-90s.
Oh, okay. So,
it's just a standard 8-inch SCT. It's my usual Star Party scope.
I've been trying to save away pennies. You know, I shouldn't say this within earshot of my wife, otherwise you guys are going to see something come across the camera thrown at me. Yeah. But I've been trying to save away my pennies for the CPC 800 because all of my other telescopes are all really short focal length. So they're very fast, very wide field, but they're absolutely worthless for planetary. So I've been kind of eyeing the CPC 800 because I can put the Hyperstar on it because those guys that make them are right down the road, like an hour down in Tucson. And,
Star Arizona, I've been there.
Yeah. So when I want to image, you know, I can turn it into like an F1, but then if I want to have people in the backyard and actually be able to show them Jupiter or Saturn and have it look decent, then, you know, I can use the full 200 or 2000 millimeter focal length of the CPC 800.
Very cool.
All right, here's Gary's view, and this is a live view of your telescope, right, Gary?
This is a live view. In fact, right now I'm
make
going
it dance.
To
make it dance. Make it dance, telescope.
I'm sending it to its parking position.
That's awesome.
Put it to bed.
Peter, do you have an image you can share of the mighty plane wave?
Yes. No, not at the moment, but I can post one up for
the mighty plane wave.
Yeah.
And there's Ray's telescope.
Yep. There's my action shot of my telescope. That's just a 8-inch Newtonian reflector on a equatorial mount. So it's a F4, 800 millimeter focal length. So it's great for getting objects like galaxies and things like that. But like I was saying earlier when I was talking with David, worthless when it comes to Jupiter and Saturn.
All right. And then do you have a picture of your telescope? I muted you. I was getting a bunch of noise.
Yeah, no, I was moving. No, I was looking for one. It's on my Google Plus feed, but I don't have one immediately available.
All right.
It looks like a refractor. That's what it is.
An awesome refractor.
Awesome refractor.
I love your telescope.
Yeah, you've got a really lovely telescope.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. Cool. Well, I think we're ready to wrap this up. So thank you very much, David, and thank you, Gary, and thanks, Peter, for. I don't even know what time it is there for you. Is it morning? Is it night? Yesterday? Is it tomorrow?
3 p.m.
Yeah. 3 p.m., all right.
Yeah, I'll be on the Hangout-a-thon at CosmoQuest. I'll be in the first session, I think, about 1 a.m. Central Time next Sunday. And we're going to do a live cross from a Melbourne laneway with a citizen science in the laneway process where we're going to do some live asteroid hunting with a crowd of people and do a live cross into the hangout, which would be great. So
we're not going to be, that's sort of an important point, so we're not going to be doing a virtual star party next week because we're going to be participating in the CosmoQuest 24-hour Hangout-a-thon, and so we'll be trying to live stream into that. So it'll feel like the virtual star party, but we'll be joining their 24 hours at various times. I think we've got a couple of slots. We'll be jumping in and streaming some live stuff. So that's going to be happening next week. You can get all that information over at CosmoQuest, and we'll be posting more information this week on my feed and in the virtual star party and over on Universe Today. So
yeah, cool. And I'll be on the Hangout-a-thon talking about Cosmo Academy, all of our different classes, our educational offerings. I believe that segment starts Saturday at 4:15 p.m. Central time.
Yeah, I haven't gotten I haven't checked my slots yet, but yeah. So you can find out more information over on CosmoQuest, and this is gonna be really fun. It's also gonna be fun to watch Nicole and Pamela go crazy on screen over 24 hours. So awesome. Okay, well, so thank you very much, Ray. And where can we find out more information? At Dear Astronomer.
Yeah, dearastronomer.com. And more information, like you were saying, about CosmoQuest at cosmoquest.org. So awesome. Keep looking up, everyone.
And Scott Lewis. I'm glad you made it back safe and sound. So where can we find out more?
I made it back safe. KnowTheCosmos.com. I am Bald Astronomer on Twitter. Also, real quick, letting everyone know, we've been in the news, the Virtual Star Party has, not only with Google putting out our commercial everywhere, but Discovery News actually featured us on the 7th with our Virtual Star Party astrophotography contest putting out.
Nice.
There. So the winners are all featured on there. We'll be releasing the second set of wallpapers later this coming week.
Nice.
So look forward to that.
That's great. Doing the wallpapers, that's a great idea. Super smart. Thanks, Scott.
So I get paid awesome. The big bucks over here.
I know. All right, well, thank you very much, penny. Stuart. Sorry you got clouded out. Maybe we'll get you next week.
Yeah.
All right, and so the next thing that's happening, I'm pretty sure we're going to be recording an episode of Astronomy Cast tomorrow. We're going to be doing accretion disks, I believe, but I haven't posted the event yet, but that's going to be coming up tomorrow. So thanks, everyone, for watching. Thanks, everyone, for joining us, and we will see you all next week.
Yeah. See you later, everyone.
Good night, everybody.
Thanks.